I do have to point out the appropriateness of my giving a talk on sleep at this time, when a lot of you are experiencing what is known as a circadian dip. Meaning, you've been awake for a while, you've built up some sleep drive, and unfortunately, your alerting cues have dropped a bit. So I suspect a number of you are feeling sleepy. I have to thank Dr. Karyanis for getting you up and moving, because physical activity is an alerting cue. So you're probably a little more alert than if you had not done that. We are actually creatures governed by daily rhythms. Rhythms that influence when we feel alert or sleepy, stronger or weaker, active or quiescent, hungry or sated, across the 24-hour day. These rhythms govern our biochemistry, our physiology, and our behavior, often in ways we don't even realize. All living organisms experience these circadian rhythms because all of life, from plants to insects to fish to mammals, evolved over millions of years to respond and adapt to the changing light and temperature conditions in our environment. Circadian rhythms allow us to maintain an internal representation of our external world so that we can synchronize our behaviors to that world and maximize our survival and reproduction. Oops. Sleep-wake is our primary circadian rhythm. Sleep-wake rhythms are generated by light signals that enter the eye and stimulate communication pathways between specialized cells in the retina and the suprachiasmatic nucleus, the master pacemaker in our brain. Pain can also have circadian rhythmicity. Some of you may already know this. Pain can be worse in the morning and better in the late afternoon and evening. Circadian patterns in pain seem to be associated with alterations of the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis and its cortisol output, along with changes in melatonin levels in the evening. Melatonin is our most important sleep-inducing hormone. So sleep and pain are integrally related. Pain often disrupts sleep, leading to less sleep and lighter, more fragmented sleep. And sleep disruption exacerbates pain. In fact, recent research suggests that sleep disruption is a stronger and more reliable predictor of pain than pain is of sleep disruption. So managing sleep is crucial to managing pain. If you are losing sleep, your threshold for and tolerance of pain is likely lower. Conversely, if you can improve your sleep, you can reduce pain frequency and pervasiveness. So what can you do to manage sleep and consequently pain more effectively? You can do three things. First, prioritize sleep. Simple, but not easy. Make sure you are not treating your biological need for sleep with that cavalier disregard that is so common to our culture. I can sleep when I'm dead. Yes, we can overcome the imperatives of our biology to a certain extent. We do it all the time. But we do it at a cost. The cost for people with chronic pain is more frequent and widespread pain. To protect your sleep, put a few basic strategies in place. First, make sure your sleeping surface is comfortable and your sleep environment is dark, quiet, and the right temperature for you. We tend to sleep better in cooler environments, but that is not always true for people with chronic pain. After that, set the alarm if you need to get up, and then turn the clock away so you do not look at it if you are awake at night. Watching the clock at night increases sympathetic nervous system activity, which disrupts sleep and then worsens pain. Also, make sure you create strong, clear cues between bed and sleep. We are animals. And like Pavlov's dogs, we can learn to associate a neutral stimulus, such as bed, with a more activated condition, such as pain or anxiety. When this happens, bed is no longer a cue for sleep. It is a cue for conditioned wakefulness. So if you find yourself awake at night for a prolonged period of time, make sure you are awake somewhere other than bed. A comfortable spot elsewhere in your home, perhaps. If that is not an option for you, if the bedroom is your only refuge, or you increase risk to yourself by getting out of bed, make sure you create signals that are associated with wakefulness, like sitting up, on top of the covers, lights on, and signals for sleep, lying down, under the covers, lights off. So first, prioritize sleep. Second, synergize sleep and pain pathways. The same things that can lead to better sleep can also help to improve pain. For example, being more active during the day boosts your biological drive for sleep and prevents muscles from becoming deconditioned, too weak to protect your joints and body from pain. Of course, make sure, as you are increasing your activity, that you do so in a responsible way, paying attention to how your body is responding. Allowing time to relax and unwind before bedtime helps sleep to unfold more easily and reduces sympathetic nervous system activity that amplifies pain signals. What Dr. Carrion has talked about before, the mindfulness meditation, the breathing, the guided visualization done in the evening, these can all help sleep and pain. Catastrophic beliefs about functioning are common in chronic sleep and pain problems. I'm never going to be able to function if it's like this. These beliefs are often extreme, usually inaccurate, and almost always unhelpful. Learning to think about and reframe your ability to function in the context of chronic pain or sleep disruption can help both conditions. Finally, there's some interesting research suggesting that pain might be aggravated by reduced light exposure during the day, leading to circadian changes, such as increased melatonin levels at night. This raises the possibility of using bright light therapy in the late afternoon to reduce melatonin levels and pain signals. Conveniently, this would also boost sleep drive because light is our most powerful circadian sleep-wake cue. So you prioritize sleep, you synergize sleep and pain pathways, and finally, you optimize, recognize, and optimize your own circadian rhythmicity. We are all subject to the 24-hour light-dark environment in which we evolved. But we have adapted to that environment in different ways. What you see here is considered a typical circadian phase. But some of us, certainly according to this, may feel naturally sleepy at 10 p.m., naturally wakeful at 6 a.m. Others of us, however, feel naturally sleepy at 2 a.m. and naturally wakeful at 10 a.m. This normal genetic variability in circadian phase is called tau. Know your tau. Work with it. Sleep in it if you possibly can, because you will always get your best sleep in your biologically natural sleep window. Tau encompasses other circadian rhythms in addition to sleep-wake. Learn what those rhythms are. Learn to recognize your own rhythms. When you feel stronger, more alert, less in pain. Match those rhythms to your periods of rest and activity, and then gradually increase the amplitude of those rhythms. Why? Because less robust circadian activity patterns seem to confer greater risk for chronic pain and for cognitive and cardiovascular problems. We seem to be the only species that routinely ignores its biological clock. And yet research shows that internal circadian synchronization is vital for health and well-being. In other words, If you can make sure that your sleep-wake, rest activity, and other circadian rhythms are synchronized with each other and with your own individual internal clock, you can achieve better physical and mental health. And that will almost certainly help with pain. Thank you. I guess I do have some time for questions. That's so nice. All right, you, sir. So the question was, how important is light to sleep? Light, of course, comes in a range of frequencies, from low to high frequency. High frequency light is blue, violet, white. Low frequency, red, orange, yellow. High frequency light, blue light, the kind that is emitted by any screen, whether laptop or tablet or phone or TV, is equivalent, not in terms of luminosity, but in terms of the frequency, is equivalent to daylight. We have specialized melanopsin-containing cells in our retina that are sensitive to blue-green light. These cells transmit the signals to that suprachiasmatic nucleus. The light allows the suprachiasmatic nucleus to suppress melatonin. So when you are exposing yourself to blue light, you are suppressing melatonin levels. Melatonin is our sleep-inducing hormone. So if you're suppressing melatonin levels, you are not as sleepy. Conversely, if you put filters on your screens, which filter out that blue light and convert it to red, orange, or yellow light, this can be done with tablets, computers, there are apps for this, there are glasses for this. You convert those daylight similar cues to dusk-type cues. Melatonin is thus not suppressed, and you can watch TV and still feel sleepy. Does that answer your question? Okay, yes, you, sir. So how, if you're thrown off of your circadian rhythms, how do you get yourself back on? Well, the first thing is to figure out what is your tau. Now, there is a test of what is called dim light melatonin onset. Melatonin typically starts to rise about 2 to 3 hours before natural bedtime. Natural bedtime is going to vary for all of us. So if my natural bedtime is 10, my melatonin will start going up at 8. If your natural bedtime is 2, your melatonin is going to start going up at 12. These tests, unfortunately, are still available mostly for research, not for commercial purposes. But if you want to know your tau, you can ask yourself some questions. Does your sleep during the week differ from your sleep on weekends? If you've ever had a time in your life when you were able to go to bed when you felt sleepy and wake up when you felt wakeful, what did your sleep schedule look like? And if you have the luxury of sleeping for a week without having any responsibilities, try it. Go to bed when you feel sleepy, get up when you feel wakeful. That will be a good indication of your tau. So the first thing you have to know is your tau. Now, not all of us can sleep in that biologically optimal sleep window. There are family responsibilities, work responsibilities, social obligations. So to a certain extent, we are all able to re-entrain ourselves according to environmental cues, those same cues that we evolved to respond to: light, temperature, physical activity, social activity. The tricky part nowadays is we are in a 24/7 environment, or we have that option, which is why we, alone among species, routinely override our circadian cues. So you first have to recognize your tau. You then have to recognize that there are these circadian cues available to help you re-entrain, and then you have to start sticking to a schedule. If you can sleep in your tau, start doing it and keep it consistent. The most important thing for maintaining that tau is the morning rise time. That's when everything gets reset. We are most sensitive to morning light. So that's when your sleep drive gets reset, your body clock gets reset. So figure out your tau, make sure you get up at the same time every morning. Make sure you synchronize your feeding and fasting patterns when you eat and when you don't eat with that. So if you're a morning person with a 10 to 6 sleep schedule, have some breakfast in the morning. If you're a night owl and you're on a 2 to 10 schedule, don't start eating until 11 or 12 when you get up. But make sure you eat meals consistent with your circadian phase. I'm going to stop there. One other thing I should say, if you're talking about lighter or more fragmented sleep, there are certain techniques used with cognitive behavioral therapy. Cognitive behavioral therapy is a very flexible treatment. It can be used to treat anxiety and pain, insomnia and depression, and there are techniques that we use in CBTI, cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia, that would address some of that sleep fragmentation that you're describing. Yes.
Well, you may have just answered this, but you're suggesting then you can retrain yourself, your circadian rhythm.
Yes, we have evolved to be able to do that. In fact, our typical circadian phase is 24.2 hours, and our day is 24 hours. So every morning when we get up, we re-entrain, whether we realize it or not. Yes?
Yes. How about taking melatonin? A lot of friends use melatonin. It doesn't work for me, but what do you think about it?
So melatonin, remember, is a sleep-inducing hormone that's released a couple of hours before your natural bedtime. It really is not that effective as a sedative hypnotic taken at bedtime because your own melatonin's already been released. So it's putting water in the pond. Doesn't make that much of a difference. However, if you have what is called a delayed circadian phase, so you're a night owl, you don't feel sleepy until 3 in the morning, and you can't afford that because you have to be up at 8, then very low doses of melatonin taken 5 hours before bedtime are extremely effective circadian phase shifters. You have to use that in conjunction with dim light, bright light, other things, but that's how it is typically and effectively used. Yes, sleep can be one of those things that is disrupted by concussion, and the more serious the mild TBI, traumatic brain injury, is, the more serious the sleep disruption. It's not always an exact ratio. Some people can experience what seems to be a mild concussion with pretty significant sleep disruption, and other people, that's not a symptom. The best thing you can probably do for that is continue with physical activity because that will help to boost sleep drive, maintain a very regular sleep schedule, and don't get caught in what can happen when people suffer from sleep difficulties, which is start to extend your time in bed. That is actually the worst thing you can do. I'm going to have to stop there because we're on to our next speaker, but thank you very much.